This is our overlay sheet printed on the inkjet film from Papio. The print quality on this, I think, is extremely good for an inkjet printer, just an ordinary old HP printer. This film's 4,000ths thick, and it's adhesive-backed, and the inkjet ink completely sinks down into it. It does not sit on top like a lot of photo films, where you can see like the black will actually be physically piled up on top of the film. This actually soaks completely into the film, disappears. But this will get covered with a overlay film, which is also 4,000ths thick, which will actually give the protective surface, keep it so that it's completely safe from, you know, solvents and fingerprints and scratches and your normal everyday use. So this has to be precisely cut to match the lines, and having to do a lot of these, we had to do something to make this a little bit more expedient. You also notice that on this design there's a radiused corner there which follows the top of the box. And that's a little tricky to cut by hand and have them look nice. The other issue is we're cutting this film and applying it first, then applying the overlay film over top of it. And as you can see the shape here of the film that we're doing, we've got an outline here which we are going to follow. And it wraps around the box. Why is it a big deal about putting the overlay sheet on separately on top of the film rather than laminating them flat together first, cutting them out once? If you're doing a flat surface and there's no bends in your overlay, then it's all out the window. Definitely put the overlay sheet on first and cut them as one unit and then stick it on. But since I'm going around a corner here by design, there's an issue with the bending stress in the film. This might sound like really going crazy here, nitpicking wise, but it really does matter. The film is 4,000ths of an inch thick, so we're replicating the corner here, looking at a cross section of the corner, and we're looking at the film with the print on it, and then the cover film on top. If you put them together, the neutral axis, when you bend something, neutral axis is where its length doesn't change. And this corner, we looked at this as the neutral axis. This inside goes into compression when it bends. This outside goes into tension when it bends. The further the strands are, the further the outsides of the parts are from the neutral axis, the more stress it takes to bend it. So if we put the two together, we have an 8,000ths thick film with a neutral axis in the middle, 4,000ths away. So now we have the outside and the inside both having to change distance significantly more, which basically just makes it much stiffer to bend. Why does that matter? Well, when the film wants to stay straight, even when we do it as a single layer, what that means is it wants to stay straight right here at this bend. It's going to want to lift off here. It's going to be the adhesive here is going to be in tension. It's going to be pulling. This wants to pull away and be straight. It doesn't want to lay down flat. So if you double the thickness, it makes that even worse. And what can happen over time, depending on how good the adhesive match up with your substrate is, how well they are designed for each other, this could actually lift off and bubble and leave a film where this will have a bulge and then come down and be attached. And you've probably seen that before in other adhesive things. So that's why I'm doing it in two separate moves. And it also has to do with the templates that I show you for cutting, why the template for the matte film, the one that's going on top, is 6,000ths on a side longer than the one for the film. And that's because the difference in diameter, the actual circumference change when you have something like this, is basically diameter times pi, delta diameter times pi, gives you your delta circumference. So up here we have 2 degree draft on the case, which means there's 88 degrees of arc here. So 88/360 gives us the amount of that full circumference times the 8,000th diameter, because this is a radial dimension, so it's twice that. This 4,000th becomes 8 diametric times pi, end up with 6,000ths. Difference in length. This neutral axis is 6,000ths of an inch longer than this neutral axis. So I actually have to cut this sheet down here where it ends 6,000ths longer than this one, otherwise it would have a 6,000th step there. So we need templates to cut the film. So I don't want to turn this into a machine shop forum, so I'm just going to give a brief description of how I make these. This dimension, the width here, and this dimension on both of them will be identical. So I super glue 2 pieces of blue temper spring steel. This is 1045 steel, and it's hardened to 48-52 Rockwell. Blue tempered spring steel is, I mean, a general shop item. So it's nice and flat. It's hard enough that a knife blade won't dig into it. Grinds nice and everything. So I glue these two together. I do all my surface grinding of my dimensions of these dimensions, but I make it to the size of the matte film size. After I've got that all done, pop it apart and take the 6,000ths off of the film one, off of each of these edges, and I've got what I'm after. And these I'll just clamp down to the film, as you'll see, and that corner needs to be cut round. So that is on the film, and I need to match it exactly to that corner radius. And my viewfinder's backwards when it's flipped facing me, and I'm just not used to that yet. So what do we do about that? I'm obviously not going to, in theory, I could have made that contour be on the spring steel, but cutting around that edge would be a nightmare. So take a round piece, and I make it such that I'm cutting the radius that I'm after. It's got a cross section here where you can see the edge there. It's got a 20 degree included angle edge that's on the exact radius. So basically I turn this in the lathe and then cut the piece out of, heat treated it. You can see where the heat treatment's there in the center. I flame hardened the center and then tempered it. Then cut it in a segment out of it and then ground it precisely to the right dimensions. So now this can nest right into this corner as we cut these. I can just slide this right in. And you'll see that when I lay one up. So we're going to take a sheet, take our plate, lay the film on, put my film on top here, my template on top, and then very precisely line this up. And yeah, you'd say, well, you know, what difference does it make making 6,000ths of an inch adjustments when you're going to put this thing on by hand? But your eye can see differences, not exact dimensions, but differences in alignment, very, very precise. Your eye's capable of really amazing things when you're talking about very small distances. So I'm just visually lining this up to get this to be right on the money. All the way around. Then put my clamp on like that, and then this just nests right in the corner. I can slide it right in all the way flush and then just give it a pop. You can hear it click through. You can actually, if you do it slowly, you can hear it click through the film and then the bottom sheet also, but we don't really need to go through the bottom sheet, just need to go through the film. Slide it in, click. Slide it in, click, and there we have it. So now the corners are done. Let me take our trusty X-Acto knife and we cut right through, and you can get used to what the pressure is to go just through the film and not through the blank sheet. So even though I'm cutting on directly, you notice I'm cutting directly on steel there, I'm actually not cutting into the steel. I'm just cutting, and I'm also only going right to where the circle cut was. Okay, so now we've got them all cut. Now we'll peel the top layer off, the actual excess outer rim of the film, and we will peel it off so that when we go to install these, we're only working with the very bottom layer there. I'm not sure I got all the way through that time. Around, peel this all off. And there you have it. Now we've got our precision cut film. And now we just have the sheet where we'll be able to peel that off and apply it to the box. Now for the film, we don't have any alignment. So we can just take the overlay, the matte film. We can just do that. We can just throw it on anywhere because here we don't care. And we can pop the corners, and that's why these will line up very precisely where you just about won't be able to see the fact that they were two different sheets. So exact same procedure. I won't go through that, but we'll end up with a cut sheet of the overlay that's 6,000ths longer on each edge to account for the growth in length because of the thickness of the film. So we're applying the overlays now, taking an isopropyl alcohol wipe over the cases. Cases have all the machining that I did to them previously. All is all done.
Now this fixture is to align the
overlay. So it's cut so that the width of the ears on this are
fit in between the pins both directions,
and this is sitting tangent on this corners of the box. Now I'm going to make this look easy, and I say that not in arrogance, but because I've made every possible mistake known to man in applying these and learned from that. So now I've got it down to a pretty good working situation. So one of the things we have to do is peel up the ends here. We don't want to touch this film with our fingers on the glue side. So we're, let me get one that I actually cut. We're taking one here and we're lifting the corner with our tweezers, lifting up the film so that we can stick a piece of the backing paper from the film on here to be able to handle this separately. If I could magically cut it from behind and leave that piece on there, I would, but I can't. So get the corner, get the corner down here, see what we're doing, lift this up, put it down here so we can get the corner under. Make sure you're using the non-stick side of the piece of paper, which I've done before. Okay, and then we bring this back into place. All right, so now we've got our pieces lined here, and these are also the backing paper with the non-stick side up. The reason these are here is this film adheres extremely strongly. Once it touches, it's history. So there's no second chances here. There's no picking it up and starting over. So we're just leaving that little teeny strip there in the center where we can do that. So here's how we peel the paper off. This is the easiest way to do it, like that, so we don't stretch the film. All right, there's our piece ready to apply. We'll get the fixture back in camera here, and we'll show you how we and we pick this up. Any little speck of anything that gets on these has to come off because it will form a bump that will be seen through the film. So we have this ready and we need room for this to be able to move. And we set this down in the pins. And it's just a snug fit right between there. And what that does is it aligns it. One of the reasons it's important to align this exactly is we're going to be drilling holes through each one of these hole locations. So we need something to reference this overlay exactly so that when I stick the same fixture into the mill with clamps on it to drill all the holes through both the overlay and the box, that they line up and I'm not having to pick up each one or they're crooked or sideways or whatever. So now I just let this float and then I touch down in the center. Dowel pin, and I just roll here to engage it. Now, very careful not to roll up onto the edge of the paper. Take it out of the fixture. I get on here, get ready to roll one direction. Film is so tenacious that if it sticks down and an air bubble's there, you've got an air bubble, it ain't coming out. So you gotta be very careful. So that's why we're rolling this down, holding the film up so it can't contact until it's rolled down in sequence there. Okay, off one side. Back on this side. Take our protector film off. Hold it tight so it doesn't fall down and get an air pocket. Roll across this. I'm actually letting that dowel pin roll in my fingers here. I'm putting down pressure on. I'm making sure I don't roll over the edge and get it out of place. Grab my Teflon burnisher, just a chunk of Teflon faced off on the end. You don't want to use abrasive. It has to be something where you machine it smooth. If you sandpaper, there'll be grit embedded in there and you'll scratch your surface. Now I can take this, burnish my film down. And keep in mind this, I mean, it's pretty obvious. This technique could be used to redo an overlay for a meter face or whatever, a custom meter face. So now we're going to roll these corners over. And right now, this is where that stress in the corners that I was talking about would come into play. This was double thickness. There'd be a lot more stress in that corner trying to lift off the corner. But this nice thin film is only 4,000ths thick. This will wrap that edge very nicely without any problem. Other side. And it's important to travel from one end to the other so that you don't, even though it's laying flat, that you don't trap air underneath here. Because this is permanent adhesive. After this has been on a week or so, it will not come off without leaving half the adhesive still stuck to the case. Working our way down. Same thing, we got all four corners. Okay, we're good. All right, nice case, got a film on it. Now, if you weren't gonna get it dirty and get it wet or have any chemical splash on it, we could leave it as is, but not so. So now we're gonna do the exact same thing again, except this time with the cover film. So we'll put the cover film ears. We'll do the putting the protective strips in here. If I could get a hold of them. Like that. There's a little piece right there on the inside. That's the kind of thing you have to watch for that does not get on the piece. Okay, that was on the top. Same thing on the other side. Grab this. All right, now that's ready to put on. Bring our fixture back. Bring our box back with film. actually, this box is a little tiny bit loose in the fixture. They're actually snug in most of the time. So now we're going to put our same pieces on. You forget any of these, and you've got a junk fixture. You have to rip it off, or junk part. You have to tear everything off and start over again, which I've done many times. But I've got it down to somewhat of a science now. So peel the film off. You already saw how I did that backwards with the film side down. Come over top, and there's a little bit of static, so it'll tend to jump up onto it. So as you just saw there, they jumped right up onto the film. And the problem with that is they jumped on so that they were in the way of the corners. And we can't have that. They got to be far enough away that there's room for this thing to float around and self-center. And it's still out of place. We need to redo that. You saw the static jump there, and there's got to be room enough that the cardboard doesn't, or the backing strip doesn't keep this thing from self-centering. And this side is. So peel this off. Do this one again. When I'm on a roll doing these, it gets down to be pretty foolproof. It doesn't take me this much messing around each time. So same thing now. Now I let this float. I let that thing sit so that's why it has to be free, so that the edges of the film are actually grabbing on the pins. Then I come down and touch in the center. Take my pin, get it engaged so that it's aligned. Pop this out. Get the fixture away. Get our pin ready. Peel the protective film off. Get ready to roll across. Okay, here's that side. Lift this side. Same thing. You touch that film with your finger and get a fingerprint on the inside, you'll get a halo of it on the overlay, even after you burnish it down. Now we'll take our same burnisher, work our way from the center out. If you've got very, very faint, just like silvering bubbles, they will push out, but any actual full-size bubble will not come out. You'll have to rip the whole thing off and start over again. Okay. No silvering. We're good. Work our way tight around the corners. Got a little piece there on the edge. This kind of thing that you got to watch out for is little things that jump on from static. Roll over. That's one side. Roll this corner. Places where it's not rubbed down are very visible, and like I said, as long as it's not a real actual bubble, any place that's just like a light silvering will pop right, will come right down. Gotta work your way across so you don't trap any air. Like I said, I'm making this look easy, because as you saw, there's, even having practiced and done 28 of these, it's an accident waiting to happen. Okay, so there's what you can do with extra precision. You'll see here, I'll come to this edge, and I'm just going to trim whatever might be the minor misalignment, which basically is non-existent on this edge. This edge might have a little bit bigger. Just making sure that there's nothing there to trim. That's how precise, by laying it out in 3D CAD and making a precise template, that those things line up. You'll see that the edges all line up flush and get a real professional looking case ready to go.
I hope you found this interesting and informative. If so, please give it a thumbs up and check out the other Versa-Ohm construction videos.